history of Klal Yisrael is all here, beginning in Sefer Bereishis, and few parshiyos of Sefer Shemot. And when Hashem Yisborach met at the Brisbane Absol with Avraham Avinu, he was telling him, Vehemin, the Pasuk says, Vehemin b'Hashem, he believed in Hashem, v'yachsheveh roi tzedokah. And that was to his credit, that he was a ma'amin b'Hashem. Because Hashem Yisborach, who created the world, the purpose was to have an Am HaNivchor, that we were privileged to be the one, to be Makabel the Torah, and it was part of that deal that we have to be Ma'aminim, and we turned out to be Ma'aminim B'nai Ma'aminim. So when tragedies befall Klal Yisrael, it's very difficult to bury it. But as time goes on, we find out that the tragedy had a purpose, and it's turning out to be to the prophet of the cloud. Sam Soifer said, when Moshe Rabbeinu was asking for forgiveness after the Egel, Hashem Yisborach said to him, that were Isu as a choirai ufonai loyei rabu. And Sam Soifer says that that means that sure, Klal Yisrael will go through many difficult times. And you will be wondering, is that what an Am HaNivchor should get? But ufonai loyei rabu, you won't know at the beginning when it's happening, but when it's ending, you will see that it had a good purpose. It's 65 years since liberation of the Holocaust. And when we were liberated, it was difficult to be happy. Many people felt, why was I the one who wasn't able to be one of his Makadish Hashem Rabbim? And we did not know that we had another thing to accomplish. And as time goes on, 65 years later, we can see that the Chorban of what the Holocaust did and was taking out so many people of Am Yisrael, Gedoyre HaToyra, small children, whole families, that was not left Echot Be'ir, Echot Be'mishpocha. It was very tragic, and still it's tragic. But we see 65 years later that those who were somehow privileged and picked by the Ribono Shel Olam to continue, look how the face of the American Jewry looks today, and also in Eretz Yisrael and the whole of Eretz Yisrael, you can see that Yiddishkeit is growing from day to day to a point that we can understand now that those who have the Amunah in Hashem was a real tzedakah. Now, I went through many nisyonos, like many of the people who were experiencing that. And everybody was taking it differently, and everybody had a different opinion sometimes about it, but the end was that those who had Emunah and Betochen, even if it was not on the highest Madrega, it was easier for them to go through the difficult days. And if you are interested in some of details that how it took place, I will be happy to give you an idea how it was.
What we'll do now is we're going to take questions. A few guys asked me questions beforehand, so I'll start with those. Afterwards, You'll say your question, I'll call on you, and I'll repeat the question to my grandfather, and then he'll give an answer. One of the questions that the boys mentioned was about miracles, and if you saw any miracles yourself, or you saw the hand of Hashem.
It was very difficult to exist under the circumstances that we were in. Nevertheless, every little sign that we had that was encouraging was a great help to make our emunah more worthy. For instance, in my own situation, I was privileged in one respect, that when we arrived in Auschwitz, you were undressed in one room, and you had to leave all your things, whatever you had, and you went to another room to prepare you for the coming days. And I happened to have my tefillin in my jacket pocket. So as I was undressing, I took my tefillin and I put it under my arm, and I went into that room naked. And the guy, there were people from the prisoners, Jewish people, who were set up by the Germans to be in charge. Their name was Kapos. We called them Kapos. And I came in, and he met me, and he saw that film. He took it. He said, "You won't need this," and he threw it away. And as he threw it away, it happened so that the room had an opening between the ceiling and the wall, a narrow opening about like this. And he threw it away, and it happened to wind up to go through that opening. And next day, as we were in one group, waiting what's coming next, it was a Sunday, and they were not going to work. There was one fellow who was coming to look for whose are these tefillin. And when I got those tefillin back, you can imagine how much of a impact it gave on me to see that there is some things that are working out even under these circumstances that we were in. This is one of those things.
Besides the mitzvah tefillin, were there other mitzvot that you tried to do or had Mesiras Nefesh to do? Maybe like Hanukkah something?
Everybody who was in that madrega coming from home to being a shomer Torah or mitzvahs was always ready and trying to figure out ways how to do a mitzvah. You couldn't. Eating, you couldn't eat kosher. It was impossible. What was possible is that you were not eating that real treif schoira, that you were trying to stay away from it. And even though you knew that nothing was kosher there, but nothing was to be eaten either. So you didn't feel too bad about it. But when it came to do mitzvahs, that was difficult. There was no Shabbos, there was no Yom Tov. And the only thing we used to do, it was one of the most important things, that you should not be alone. If you had family, then you would get together with family members. If you didn't have family, then you were making a chabura of 3-4 people. And that was the most important thing. One was watching the other. If you didn't have that, that was a very difficult situation. So, for instance, on Friday night, there was nothing much to eat. The food that they were giving us was a piece of a bread that was as big as a brick. And it was hard like a brick too, and it was more sawdust than flour in it. And as we were coming in from work, there were 7 people in one row. So one row got a bread. Now imagine seven hungry people go to divide to seven pieces, a hard piece of something. And that was also designed for making it more difficult. But Friday night, for instance, all Chavrusa that we were four guys together, we used to get together and sit down on the bench, and not a bench, it was where we were sleeping. It was just a plain brick, plain wood it was all the way, like all this room, it was one built, and you were sleeping on that wood. But it was one thing, it wasn't hard wood, it was soft wood. Yeah. So we used to get together there Friday night and still arise, slowly try to sing some mirrors to still arise and talk about what we used to eat and remember the kugel and the fish and say at the bar Torah. Those were things that you could do with Sina, with old people to be aware of what's going on. One thing, one of the easiest things to do was that you didn't have to be afraid that they would catch you to be Mechadir Zerovona. Mechadir Zerovona, you went outside with another guy and two people together, like you were walking there, and you were Mechadir Zerovona. But that nobody knew about that. And that was the easiest mitzvah that you could really do. But as far as Hanukkah is concerned, we read in the paper sometimes that some of the Doyle and Torah who were there were able to do some kind of things. I don't know, it's possible. I wasn't there. And each place had its different ways how to catch. For instance, I was working in a group of 30 people, our work was to clean offices. And after we cleaned the offices,
How old were you then?
How old was I then? 29, I was 25. And during the day, we had to take care of the trees, to trim the trees, and to take care of the gardens around there. So on Sukkot time, we were trimming the trees. So what we were able to do, we were putting together the bunches, like to make a form of a sukkah. It wasn't a kosher sukkah. But if even Raya the Dover, at least Zeche the Dover, we had to remember the today's sukkah. We were able, for instance, to daven on Rosh Hashanah. We were, after we finished working, we went downstairs and one of the guys was standing at the door to watch that the SS guy who was watching us is not coming close. He was at the door to be sure that nobody is leaving. So in the meantime, before Rosh Hashanah, we were getting together and asking the guys, do you remember the parts of the Tuman Ezra? What part do you remember? And we put together and we were sure that the Ramban was listening to those speakers. But those were the type of things that you were trying to do. And that was the best thing you could do. But to be really doing what you wanted to do was very difficult.
Excuse me. I do have a question about the Holocaust in general. You don't have to run the show. He's the boss, he's on the show. My biggest question would bother me. I'm 63 years old, biggest question about me. How do you explain to the boys, to me, to yourself, has God killed 1.5 million children?
How do you explain to everybody that Hashem killed 1.5 million children?
From your point of
view, that's very easy.
Not what the Rabbani said.
That's very easy to answer. Because people who are Ma'aminim don't ask that question. Because they believe that Hashem's Baruch was doing it that way, that had
they had a purpose of this one day. Chofetz Chaim is explaining, perhaps that would answer your question, is that Hashem, that when you go to the tailor that you want to sell you a suit, is going to get the material. Beautiful material comes in a bulk, and you would not go to take a scissor and go and cut it up. But you cut it up, you are ruining it. So he says that it seems like that before you want to make something like a suit, you have to take something and to ruin it. And you are not realizing at the time that from this piece of material, you will have a nice suit. And this look back 65 years after liberation. It's a great tragedy that thousands of Gedolei Torah and some plain Jewish people, with small children, mamas and tatas and babas and zaydis, had to pay with their lives. In their lives was not Bechinam gone, it was our Kiddush Hashem. And today, 65 years later, you see that you have a new suit. You have a new arrangement of Klal Yisrael, that people are coming and they want to be joining those who are Ma'amin and B'nai Ma'amin.
Yeah, but I will ask again. I'm sorry, I sound like Pikoyas, but everybody is a shtickler of Pikoyas. Rav Soloveitchik used to say, everybody allowed to have his doubts about God. There's nothing more holy in Chazal from children. Whenever somebody's sick, I didn't go to Rabboni. I take $100, I go to a cheder, I give to the Rebbe, buy them candies, buy them lollipops, let the kids to say Kapitul Tili. It's more for my Kapitul Tili. Children is the most holy by Kodesh Baruch Hu. They never did sins. What Kodesh Baruch Hu did to them? Why?
So you have tainus to the Rabboni?
I didn't tainus, I'm questioning. I want you to answer me from your point of view to convince them that the boys. I'm not convinced. Maybe you can convince them and convince me.
No.
Maybe I'm shaken. Possibly.
Yeah, the Golem who cannot answer you that question differently than
I'm
what is telling
you. You believe the God. I'm asking you. You went through the experience. You're an angel. How you look at this?
I don't have that question.
You don't have this question?
For me, it's not a question.
Why?
Because if that was the Rotzer Hashem, then that is no question to ask. That was the Rotzer Hashem. This is not the first time it happened in our history. In our history, wherever they touch the posse that we say about the Seder, the Evoir Olaich, the Erech Nisboiseses Bedomayich, the Oymar Loch Bedomayich Chayim, is Alim. Alim has a tight leaves. Ale Zayas, Ale Tomori. So the tight deposit of wherever Olaich, if we go through our history book, the pages of our history book, the Erech is Boiseses, the Domayich. And I see how much blood goes through that people had to give because being a Jew. But to Oymar Loh, the answer to that question is, if you ask why, that Bedomai Chayi, that there will be a Chayis, you will have a schar for that. How and when and why? I don't have that question. And by Toya Barshem, that's why Emuno does not
when
go in, without bitochen.
When you are in the camp, you feel the same thing like you're talking now?
Exactly. More so. Because when you were in the camp, you knew that your life is not worth the life of a fly. You were, any moment, you were ready to give up your life. A guy came by, one of the couples came by. He didn't like the way he was standing. He took his shtecken
and he gave you a knock over the head, and you fell over there, and that was the end of it. So you knew that, that your life is garnished. And if it does happen, you know that you were Makadish Hashem.
Did you lost any clothes?
No. No, we had at the
beginning. No, children?
Did you lose any close relatives? Close relatives.
Okay, did I?
Did you lose close relatives?
I lost my father, I lost all my brothers.
All of them?
With their families. I had a sister, who lived here in Jerusalem. I had a brother who lived in Nebrak. They were listed by mass. They were not part of the Holocaust, Baruch Hashem. And you have no questions. If you are a Mamin, then you have no questions. You have to have a betochen. The next part of it is that besides
what gave you the emunah?
What gave you the emunah?
What gave you the... What makes an individual think that Rabbeinu Shalom gave you a moyach and a leiv that you think, and between the two you make up the, what you want to think about. And that's how emunah comes about. If you see that people are falling like flies and before your eyes, your own life does not have any more value than what the Rebbeinu Shalom gave the Tanshuma in your body. But you, as far as your body is concerned, what are you worried about? That you are having sorrows right now, you don't mind if they'll take your body. And as far as the Tanshuma is concerned, is the Rebbeinu Shalom will have back his Tanshuma will have the Kiddush Hashem. And if that was his will, yeah, Masha, yeah. And without that, you would not be able to make it.
What you answer, people come and say to you, if this is my God, I don't want to be part of it.
People who say, this is my God, I don't want to be a part of it. What do you answer?
What I answer? There is no answer to that. That's what I was telling you at the beginning. If a Mamin has something, he don't have no questions. If one is a real Mamin, has no questions. And if one is a Mamin, then you don't need an answer. You cannot answer him. Whatever you tell him, he will accept that answer. And maybe that there's supposed to be a certain Madrega in that Emunah. Because there is Emunah Pshita, and there are all kinds of Madregas in Emunah. I feel, Baruch Hashem, to have an emuno shalema. Don't we say, ani ma'amin be'emuno shalema? Why do you have to say shalema? Ani ma'amin be'emuno. So you see that emuno goes from here all the way to Madregas and Madregas and Madregas. And I feel that I have an emuno shalema. And I know that many of the people who were liberated with me had the same feeling. And if we had a problem, the problem was, what am I going to do now? I wasn't able to walk on my legs after liberation. What's going to happen? My mishpocha is old, I'm told. I have no home, I have no place. Well, what am I? Wouldn't it have been better if I was being on Kiddush Hashem with all the other, those who were going to go to Kiddush Hashem? And as days were coming, you got better, and your heart and your mind was trying to warm, you came to the conclusion that there is a tomorrow, and you have to be mechazik yourself, and not only you were not able to do that by yourself, but as you saw that there was Gedolim who were among those who were liberated. And they were coming, they stepped up and they showed the way. And they were gathering the people, and we were feeling that we have chizuk, and we are building up. We came in, who was thinking about to be able to get married? You lost your mind being the time in the concentration camp. You were not counted to be a human individual. And if you are not counted to be a human individual, you didn't feel like a human. You felt like a worse than a plain animal. They did with you what they wanted to. And how in the world gave the Rebbeinu Shalom, the same Rebbeinu Shalom who did all these horrors, caused all these horrors, gave koyach to those who were determined to leave, to re-establish Klal Yisroel. Look around, all these Palatin who came back from there, and they were able to establish families, the shame of the parents. Doesn't that answer your question?
Mary, I understand every word what you say now, but when you were there 65, 70 years ago, did you never get the momentum? God, what the hell, why are you doing this to me?
Did you ever feel for a moment that God should be out of the picture?
When you were there,
you were there 65 years ago.
Now you're the king.
No, that was the only thing that kept me going from day to day.
You never got the momentum of
that I knew that there is a Rebbeinu Shalom and if that he is real.
Okay, but you never got the momentum of why?
No, I have no questions.
Then, not now. When you were there.
Then either.
You never got the momentum of why?
No, it was more important then not to have questions than today.
Amen.
Okay, we'll take some questions from the crowd. Again, you'll say the question, I'll repeat it.
The Kabbalists, how did the Jews that were the campers, how did they come in?
How did everyone deal with the Kabbalists themselves? They were Jews.
So that's all this about this. No, so the movies.
People there. How did they deal with the Kabbalists that were being good at them?
The way you dealt with the Kabbalists that you had to try to not to be known. For instance, every morning at 5 o'clock you had to stand in line already. The whole group was ready to go out to work. There were people who came down late. You became already a person that they knew you. And once you became a person that you were already marked for whatever thing, that was bad. You had to try to be an Easter. That you are one of the guys and you are not showing you that you are around.
So, next question.
Now, is there anything you suggest specifically to raise our level of emunah?
What would you suggest for the boys to raise their level of emunah?
That depends on the individual themselves. You cannot take, it's not like a pill, that you will take a pill, your stomach doesn't work right, and you take a pill or two, and now it's okay. And now I can go back and eat again the same thing that caused me the problem. It doesn't work by emunah. By emunah, you'll be talking, it's something to eat, and it's gathered, or you don't gather. And it depends in your own will to make up your mind and close your eyes and think, how did I get here? How did you get here altogether? Who is making you able to breathe, or who is giving you the ability that by breathing you are able to go on from today till tomorrow? If you are not coming to the point to establish that comes from the Rebbeinu Shalom, then you cannot start to have a woman. First you have to believe that there is a Rebbeinu Shalom. Once you believe that there is a Rebbeinu Shalom, now you can talk to yourself you know yourself, you know how far you can go, and you can say, what am I doing? Am I giving thanks to the one who gave life to me? If you are feeling that your life has a value, then you will try to work towards that, you will have a moment. And if you think that, well, who cares? And you don't have to have a moment. Forget it.
Next question? Yes.
You went through so much to put on tefillin, you could have given up your life every day. Someone could have killed you if they found you with this tefillin. What would you say now to so many of the, you know, Jews, you know, of my generation, that even in a country with free religion, and even in Israel, in a yeshiva, that they don't want to put on tefillin, and they look at tefillin as a burden, and now they look at mitzvot as a burden. What would you say to them?
So much for tefillin, and you risk your life for tefillin. What would you say to those boys who don't risk their life for tefillin and might not put on tefillin on every day?
If somebody is in the position already that he is at the age to put on tefillin, and he does not understand that that is a mitzvah, mina Torah, to do, and you are wondering about that, if you should do it or not do, there's nothing to talk about.
No, my question was more, how would you respond to the people of this generation that even though they have so much freedom to do what you risk your life to do, they don't even do it?
How would you tell people who don't, you risk your life for it, and they're not, and they have so much freedom? How could you tell, what would you tell them to, I guess, have more of an interest in it, to do the mitzvah correct?
To make an individual who is already in the age of chiyuv bar mitzvah, and if you have to try to prove to him that this mitzvah has a purpose, he doesn't understand it, and he's not makabel that on himself. That in the makabel b'hanuchas tefillin l'kaya in mitzvah boiri, so you have nobody to talk to about mitzvah tefillin. The basis is that when you have a bar mitzvah, is the mitzvah should be more important than the bar. In our days, when you have a bar mitzvah, you put the emphasis on the bar more than on the mitzvah. And if that's the case, such an individual has a problem, then why should I put that on the film?
Yes. How do you say to people who deny the Holocaust?
What do you say to people who deny that the Holocaust happened?
With an answer. If somebody feels to come to the conclusion that I don't believe in something, so talk to the wall. There's nothing to talk to it. You don't believe it in party. So I cannot put a moyach on you and say and put in there that I believe in Holocaust or I don't believe in Holocaust.
How does it make you feel?
How do you feel? There are people that say that the Holocaust didn't happen. How do you feel?
Who cares about it? Let them feel what they want. Does it make any difference? The halacha, does it make any difference? It doesn't make any difference.
Yes.
Was there any thought about that? And was it just, and Hashem, it was, even if they had the opportunity, was it whatever Hashem decrees were not the ones?
Was there ever any talk about fighting back, or did you just have a munah that would never be able to?
Physically fighting back? We were not in a position to physically fighting back. We didn't have anything to fight back. We didn't have a pants to wear. You were ugly, so you were without any clothing. Who would you fight?
Was there ever any opportunity, if there would be opportunity, was there ever talk about ever?
There were. You see, you know, you read about that in the ghetto in Warsaw, that they were rebelling. if they saw a possibility to work out to rebel, they did. Didn't they? You know what they did? In order to be afraid of them, and they every few weeks they put aside 3-4 people and they were hanging them. And they said that they tried to run away. There was nowhere to run. And that's just to show that to be afraid of them that the people thinks.
Yes.
Did you ever try to, did anybody have any svarim that you're able to learn from while you're in the camps?
Were there any svarim in the camps?
No, not talking svarim. You couldn't have a piece of paper. Nowhere to put it. You couldn't have anything.
You had your tefillin?
Where did you go after the Holocaust ended?
After the Holocaust, where did you go?
After the Holocaust, I went. I was trying to get back my physical ability to come back to life. The first thought was that I'm going home and see somebody of my family. Is there anybody there? There was no communication. There were no trace. There were some, but you had no telephone. You had no cell phones. Today you cannot live without a cell phone. What's happening to the Lord? And my mind was that as soon as I have enough coin, I'll go. And I was liberated the day of Pesach Sheni. And when the ability when I got back to be able to function, to go, to walk, to think, was already about 2 weeks before Rosh Hashanah. And I figured that maybe I'll go home. I went to the railroad station in München, and who do I meet? A landsman, a fellow who was from the same state or from the same city. And, big Simcha. So I said, where are you going? Where are you going from? So I tell him, I'm going to, I want to go home to see what's happening there. He says, I'm coming from there. There is nobody, there's nothing to go for. So I went.
Take two more questions and then we're going to close up. If you have questions afterwards, you can come up.
What was the name of the shtetl that you're originally from? And what places did you go to? Which camps did you go to throughout the Holocaust?
What's the name of the city you're from? Which camps were you in?
Well, I'm a city from Hungary. You would know if I'm telling you a city in Hungary. You would know nothing to me if I tell you Bojbrig or I tell you the city's name of Nierichau. So it doesn't matter.
Which camps were you in?
I was in about a half a dozen camps. Started in Auschwitz, which I only spent.
The allocation has a lot to do. When we live in the old city of Jerusalem and everything's very easy, what can we do with our own to be Kaddish and Hashem on a similar level? Right?
What would be the message to end up? The last question. What's the way for the boys to be able to be the Kaddish and Hashem in their lives, to be able to do what you did?
The answer to that question is that it is all depending on the individual. And as I told you before, you have to have a din v'cheshbon with yourself. And nobody will say that what's wrong with this guy, he's talking to himself. Don't worry about it. You can have a nice talk with yourself and you can be straight with yourself. You know what is the true thing, which is not right, which is not the true thing. And you have to come to a final decision that what am I doing to on this world? What am I accomplishing? What for was I sent here? There must be a reason that the first thing is that you have to be sure about it and to feel that there is a Bnei Shalom. to have that, that is the first point of Emunah. If you don't believe that there is a punish on him, you don't have to talk to yourself. You can talk to the Lord. I hope that our gathering now here did accomplish something and did some, gave some chizuk to some of those who are mamin v'eina mamin. Noach was one of those guys that Rashi says that he was waiting until the rain was starting to come down before he was going into the Teva. Why didn't he go in right after together with all the other guys and close up? So that says Rashi that Noach was mamin v'eina mamin. He was, he believed, he was tzadik tomim, the doiroiso. So each of us and every individual has his madrega. We are all beyond of age of bar mitzvah. And you all should know already that there is a reason for being here and being a chelik of Klal Yisroel, for being a member of an Am HaNivchar. So where am I now? Am HaNivchar if I am not doing, not practicing what an Am HaNivchar should practice? And that's the hope that maybe our talk here about the Munayim Mitochem, that some of you or all of you will go to sleep tonight before you fall asleep, after you, that you can do that after you said Kriya Shema too. And you will say to yourself, Chaim, what am I doing in my life? What is tomorrow? Maybe tomorrow I'll come to the Shir. Maybe I should give a little more attention to what's going on. And when I put on my tefillin, I should have in mind that Vahayot Zichro and Zroya Antio, Vahroish Negra Moyach, and Shomot Jebe Moichi. You are all able, you understand already. So let's hope that this is the point that you will be able to make a difference with yourself.
Excuse me. You have a Mune, almost like Kodesh Baruch Hu, you have a Mune.
Yeah.
But this boy grew up in a Mishmash.
Yeah.
They grew up in Mishmash.
All right.
By then, Michael Jordan is more important from Rav Levinson.
Okay.
Who is Rav Levinson? Michael Jordan. High-tech, Shmaitech.
All right.
All the damage in the world.
All right.
You know, the Mishnah said, one second, the Mishnah said, against your will you go, against your will you live, and against your will you die. Let's talk about bone. Nobody asked you to be Jewish. They are by accident Jewish.
We have,
you got the moon when you are a baby. Before you born, nobody knew the Kaya Mitzvahs.
It's a mice.
But they are a mishmash.
I got your question. It's a mice. It's my symbol for your, that there are people who were so far from Yiddishkeit that you cannot be any further. And you see my symbol for Yorim, that they are turning and they come to realize that there is a Rabban Sharonim and there are Tariyak Mitzvahs and there is a reason to be a Shomer Torah Mitzvahs. Doesn't it happen daily? So there is no terrorist to anyone who says, I cannot do it.
Yeah, but when you are young, when you are young, you don't think about Kodesh Baruch Hu so much. You think about, I'm the cool guy, I'm the guy gifted, I'm God.
All right.
In
so,
my age, your age, London 20, you realize who is the boss.
So the guy,
who young people.
The guy who thinks like that, his moyer is not in the right place. He should knock it to the wall of his
dad. How do you put the wall in the
right? He should have won.
How do you put the wall in
the right? I told you to knock it.
What
did
he say?
Yeah.
So what did he say?
I want to thank you.
Without any jokes, I was a mommy when I grew up, when I was your age. And maybe that no Yashar Koach comes to me for that. It was natural. The same way that it was natural that you go to eat your breakfast in the morning and to eat your other things, it was part of her life that when you came to a mitzvah, you knew that you are a chiyuv b'mitzvot, and it was already in your head. So I grew up with it, and there were thousands of those who did so. And Elamai, you have people sometimes who grew up, where, as I said, that the bar was the emphasis more than the mitzvah. There comes a time when you can grow up when you are 16 or 17 too. If you did not grow up when you were 13, or if you had any things that were holding you back from thinking in those directions. And it's not a strange thing in our days that people who were much further from Yiddishkeit, that they are having a dinner with themselves, and they are making a decision, end of all the life that I lived, and from now on, I want to be close to the Panchal. And I hope that we will see on God will be made.
Amen. Thank you very much for coming. And